Australia's famous for its big things. The big lobster and the big Scotsman are two we've covered before on this channel. On the way to the Grampians, you may well pass the giant koala, northwest of Stawell, not merely named the Big Koala, because that already exists in Cowes, near Phillip Island. In more fruit-related matters, there's the big pears, numerous big apples, the big avocado, the big mango, several big oranges, and most famously of all, the big banana. This one's widely claimed to be the first, but it's not. Scotty the Big Scotsman actually predates it by a year. So after all those, a mere fraction of the total out there, it hardly seems surprising that in regional Victoria you can find the big tractor. But this one's not like the others at all. It's not a giant fibreglass replica of an object to pose for tourist selfies in front of. It was an actual working tractor. Well, kind of. She's called Big Lizzie, and this is her story. The story begins with a man named Frank Bottrell. Born in 1871 in Sturt, Adelaide, he apprenticed as a blacksmith and worked in the Moonta and Wallaroo mines in South Australia as a steam engine driver. He later moved to Broken Hill and started a steam engine company to transport supplies there from Adelaide, and an early venture in his first vehicle ended up with a bog down north of Morgan, SA, where, after spending days to free it, it was eventually abandoned. By 1896, he'd given up on this, moved back to Adelaide, and gone back to working as a blacksmith. But 50 years before that, a man named James Boydell patented a device known as the Dreadnought wheel. This is a wheel with a bunch of hinged plates on it that the wheel can run over for greater traction on loose ground. It's like having a bunch of max tracks strapped to your tire. Attached using a ball and socket joint to the wheel, and being the full width of the wheel, they worked, but the joint soon wore out and the ride was rough. Bottrell heard of this, and in 1906 had some ideas about how to improve it, for which he filed a patent. He used crossed wire ropes to attach half-width plates to each side so the wheel would run on each of them alternately as it travelled across the ground, giving a much smoother ride than Boydell's original and eliminating the problem of the unreliable ball joints. In 1909, he moved to South Melbourne, working with the A.H. MacDonald Company as an engineer and a blacksmith. For a while, these wheels were offered as an option on all of MacDonald's farm and industrial tractors. But then he had an idea. What if one of these were bigger? He spotted an opportunity. Currently, wool and other heavy loads could only be moved over the sandy desert terrain by teams of camels. This could clearly be done better with a motor vehicle, he thought. In 1915, he began construction on Big Lizzie. It's not really known exactly how she got this name. Some say that she was named after a huge gun on a World War I battleship, or maybe the battleship itself. But then you'd have to ask the question of why a deeply religious man who abhorred violence in all its forms, and is said to have never so much as sworn in his entire life, would name something after a piece of military weaponry. Some sources just say that Margaret Bottrell, his wife, named it. But after who or what, we don't know. Newspaper reports at the time just used the Big Lizzie name with no explanation, implying it was used to refer to it at the time, but this doesn't really help us here. Financed by the agriculturalist and inventor Ralph Faulkner, the casting and machining for the parts was done by A.H. MacDonald & Co. in their Richmond workshop, which was located on Bridge Road where the office works stands today. Early in 1916 it was ready to go. He left Richmond expecting to reach Broken Hill by early 1917. The route he planned through Victoria was via Kilmore, Heathcote, Elmore, then Echuca, where he planned to cross the Murray River into New South Wales, before heading towards Broken Hill. Driving this through the city was bad enough, racking up a sizeable bill from the damage to the hard-surfaced roads and other assorted infrastructure. When he got to Kilmore, the sheer weight of Big Lizzie overwhelmed a bridge and it went through the decking, causing the dent in the drinking water tank that was never repaired. Upon reaching the Campaspe River, a suitable crossing site needed to be found, taking 3 weeks of earthworks before a river crossing was possible. When Bottrell reached Echuca, he was unable to cross the Murray River as it was in flood. He requested to cross the bridge and was denied, possibly due to what had just happened in Kilmore. Unable to enter Echuca, he headed for Kerrang, hoping to reach Swan Hill. Reaching Kerrang in July 1917, he spent 5 months there repairing and improving Big Lizzie, so it was August before he reached Oyen. In October, he'd reached Mildura, finding the Murray River in flood again, so without a bridge that he'd be able to drive over, he was stuck on this side of the river for a few months at least. By this point, he was pretty much broke, so he sought work in the area. He spent 1918 carting wheat around, transporting as much as 80 tons on one occasion, believed to be the world record for a land vehicle at the time. He was successful in finding something to do. By August 1920, Big Lizzie was clearing scrub for a 6,000-acre settlement at Red Cliffs, the site of 700 soldier settlement blocks for World War I veterans. 16 men would follow behind and in front of Big Lizzie, attaching steel cables to tree stumps which would be ripped out of the ground. By 1924, the work was completed, and Bottrell, thinking it would be much more usable for this purpose, headed to Western Victoria to find more work clearing land. In 1926, he sold one of Big Lizzie's trailers, then got a land clearing job at Glendinning Station, one of the properties owned by Ralph Faulkner, who had financed the original construction of Big Lizzie. Tensions soon arose with the station owner due to the fact that he wouldn't work on the Sabbath, as he was a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which forbade it. Combined with repeated disagreements over finances and conditions of the share farming agreement he had entered into, eventually the agreement completely fell apart, and in 1928 Bottrell was forced to sell his share in the property and left the station, leaving Big Lizzie behind to rust in a field. In 1938, Big Lizzie's Blackstone engine was removed and sold, ending up in Pyramid Hill, where it was used to power stone-crushing equipment, remaining in use until 1942. They dismantled it and sold it for scrap in 1945. Frank Bottrell himself passed away in January 1953, then the treasurer of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Dareton, near Mildura. Big Lizzie, long forgotten, continued rusting in a field. Would anyone remember it before it turned to dust? Was it to stay there forever? In the late 60s, Ern Wolfe, an avid historian and the former Mildura Shire president, went in search of the final resting place of Big Lizzie. Surely you couldn't just lose something that big and famous, he thought. Eventually, in 1969, a friend tipped him off that the tractor was lying in a field on Glendinning Station in Western Victoria. Hearing that it could end up being sold for scrap, he knew he had to work fast. He contacted the owner of the property and arranged a visit. Borrowing $1,250 from the Red Cliffs Club, he negotiated the purchase of what was left of Big Lizzie. A further $750 raised by the club covered the transport of Big Lizzie and her one remaining trailer back to Red Cliffs in time for the year of Red Cliffs' Golden Jubilee in 1971. Big Lizzie was restored and put on display in the park at Berkeley Square, just off the Calder Highway where she stands to this date. In 2000, the second trailer was located at Haywood, and as of 2018 was said to almost be finished in its restoration, though it appears that it may not have met the original goal of having it ready for the 150-year anniversary of Redcliffe's in 2021. So let's take a look at the machine herself. Now, she's not called Big Lizzie for nothing. But how big is she really, and what does it take to make such a large machine operate? The dimensions were 10.36 metres long, 3.35 metres wide, and 5.49 metres high. Total weight was 45 tonnes, capable of carrying 10 tonnes on the engine cab and 35 on each trailer. Turning circle was 61 metres. It used a more conventional automotive-type steering system rather than the turntable-type system most tractors used, which did increase the turning circle. Used a steering wheel, 80 turns lock-to-lock. The engine was a 60-horsepower or 45-kilowatt Blackstone crude oil engine, single-cylinder. 228mm bore, 450mm stroke, this gives it about 18.5 litres of displacement, and a 215rpm design speed. Being a single-cylinder engine, this necessitated a very large flywheel. It was 2.13 metres in diameter and weighed 3 tonnes. The gearbox was 3.2 metres long by 1.4 metres deep and 0.9 metres wide. It had 4 forward gears, 2 reverse gears, and to select them there were 2 gear levers, each of which was about 3 metres long. Big Lizzie was two-wheel drive with the rear wheels driven. The speed was 0.8 kilometres an hour in first, 1.6 in second, 2.4 in third, 3.2 in fourth, 0.4 in low reverse, and 0.8 in high reverse. Fluid capacities were 430 litres of engine oil, 19,800 litres of crude oil fuel, in fact they didn't even fill it up for the first 3 years of operation, 3,400 litres of general purpose water, and 1,000 litres of drinking water, which was slightly reduced by the tank being dented in. The wheels were solid steel, with the larger wheels being 6 foot in diameter, smaller being 4 foot. But due to the wheels being 6 segments instead of the earlier design of 12, there was too much load on the bearer cables above 1.6 kilometres an hour, so this was the effective top speed, which was sadly only half of the design speed. Fuel economy was quoted as being 4 gallons per mile when it was carrying 80 tonnes. That's 1,133 litres per 100 kilometres, which would give it a total range of about 1,800 kilometres for the full tank. Presumably more economical than this when not fully loaded, but this is the only figure I can find. So I think it's pretty clear that this certainly was an iconic machine, if one that sadly didn't see as much use as it could have. But to quote the Australian Dictionary of Biography, his invention was important in the mechanical clearing of sandy country, but had no long-term impact on the development of the traction engine. The Dreadnought wheel was slowly forgotten, and the Caterpillar track won out for use on loose surfaces where the pneumatic tyre didn't suffice, making the Dreadnought wheel a footnote in technological development, promising, but ultimately a branch not further developed upon, as alternatives successively improved from where they'd started. I've previously covered another one of these forgotten alternative technologies in a different area, the light bulb. It's called the Nernst lamp, and it was a promising alternative to the carbon filament light bulb at the time. It used a ceramic filament to produce light, which could burn a lot brighter without burning out. I made some attempts to build one, some more successful than others, and you can watch that video from the end screen, or click the link in the description below. Don't forget to like, comment and subscribe, and see you next time.